going to go over today. Class is titled, Watch Your Mouth. All right?
Watch it.
Watch your mouth. Because you may say something stupid, you know? So, we always going to start up with Ecclesiastes 12 and 13. Now, this class is important. Why? Because all of us collectively, for the most part, we understand of being in the truth for about 7 years and less. For the most part, everybody in this room. Some people just a few months, some people a few years. All right, so it is very important that we watch what we say. And on top of that, we must learn what to say. All right, let's start up with Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13.
Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. Mm-hmm. For this is the whole duty of man.
All right, this is the whole duty of man. All right, our mind should always be focused on the law. All right, if we're meditating on the scriptures day and night, it becomes a part of you. All right, the old man is slowly dying away. He's getting killed off. So now we're becoming a new man, a new sister. All right, in this truth. All right, let's go to Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 21. We're just going to start off with some scripture showing how important it is about what we say. The gravity of it. Can we just say any and everything that we want to just because we feel a certain way? Let's see what the scripture says.
Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 21. Mm-hmm. Death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Read that again.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Brother Samuel, stand up. Break that down for me.
So whatever you say will come back against you.
Do what the whole scripture says. Death and life are in the power of the tongue.
So you can say some things that can harm and cause somebody to go off from the truth, or you can say some things that can help somebody and build their spirit.
Right, right. Those both ways. So what you say, it has an effect. All right? You just can't say whatever you want. All right? It'll come back on yourself. All right? You speaking evil against others, that evil's going to come back on you. All right? You teaching God's words, you building up brothers and sisters, that's life. I keep my commandments and live. All right? If you wander out of the commandments, that's death. All right, read that all with Robinson.
Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 21.
Uh-huh.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof.
And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. If you love life, what you gonna do? All right, you're gonna drink this spiritual water, this spiritual meat. All right, you're gonna study diligently because you want life. You want to see your people, you know, rise to the top. You're tired of seeing our people in this state. So you're going to learn. You're going to transform your mind, all right, so you can align it with the scriptures, all right? Let's go to James chapter 3 and verse 5. James chapter 3, verse 5. The topic is watch your mouth. Simply just watch what you're saying, all right, at all times, all right, because you will have to give an account to the Most High for that. Let's read this. James chapter 3, verse 5.
James chapter 3 and verse 5. Even so the tongue is a little member. And
I'm sorry. So the tongue is a little member going into the tongue compared to your arm or your leg or your head. It's a
or your shins.
Exactly. Yes, your shins. Yes, it is a little body part compared to your whole body. Your tongue. This little old tongue has the power to give life and death. Read again from the top.
Even so the tongue is a little member.
Uh-huh.
And boasteth great things.
Mm-hmm.
Behold how great a matter. A little kindled fire.
A little kindled fire. So, going into what we just went over, read on.
Verse 6. And the tongue is a fire.
Mm-hmm.
A world of iniquity.
A world of iniquity. Alright, because think about it. when you say you know, chilling with a wicked family member, they came through, stopping by, you haven't seen them in a long time. By their speech, you can tell what type of life they're living. All right, you, they're talking to you. Nothing's good gonna come out of their mouth. It's nothing about where the hole's at. You feel what I'm saying? Oh, we going out tonight, trying to get high, da da da. You heard about what's the name? Oh, she doing this to this dude. It's nothing but a world of iniquity. All right, we done all the through, officer.
And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members. That it defileth the whole body.
That it do what?
That it defileth the whole body.
That it defileth the whole body. Alright, that's the key. That's the key.
Let me give another example on that, about the tongue. When it says death and life is in the power of the tongue, the way you speak controls your attitude and the way you look at things. And that will affect your actions. I'll give you an example. My auntie Leonard. Every day she would call my mom and say, did you see the news? And all you see, y'all know what the news, she was the news lady. Did you see this happen? That happened? I was like, I don't care what happened. All of these is bad stuff, day after day after day after day. And I can imagine what her mindset on the world would be if that's all you feed into. And guess what? When you see it, then guess what? That's what she spoke about. And that became her reality. That was her reality, the news on TV. It's the only thing she saw. She was never able to get outside of that cycle. All right, I just had to say because it said, the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. All right?
Did you read verse 6 again?
Yep. Verse 6. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body.
It says that it defileth the whole body. So what you say defileth the whole body. Now, Soji Enoch, is that talking about that you just, without thinking about it, you just say off the wall stuff and that jacks you up? Is that what it's talking about? What is the scripture talking about?
Now, that it's about the whole body, is that with the tongue, people can murmur, they can do different things behind another person's back, or have things spread out that it can cause a lot of harm in the body.
Think about it like this. So what we say, is that something that just happens? We don't control
that? We think on that.
We think on that. So it says, read that again, officer. Verse 6.
And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body.
That it defileth the whole body. So, I'm going to ask you a question. What scripture would say that whatever's in you is going to come out? Because you're not just, it's not just going to come up, you know, you're just going to speak. It was in you already. So that's how it defiles your whole body. It was already in you. What you got?
That's out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks.
Let's get it. Matthew 12 and 34. Exactly.
All praise.
Matthew 12 and 34.
Chapter 12 and verse 34. Matthew chapter 12 and verse 34. O generation of vipers, how can ye being evil speak good things?
It says, how can you being evil speak good things? All right, we are.
For out of the abundance of the heart.
The heart is what?
The mind.
Right, read on.
For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh.
So it was already in us before we even said it out of our mouth. So that's how it defiles the whole body, all right? Because those spirits, those thoughts were in you, all right? So they just got brought to light once they came out of your mouth, all right? Let's go to Proverbs 10 and 13, all right? So the topic is watch your mouth. Proverbs 10 and verse 13. Going into men of wisdom, you can tell who's a man of wisdom by what? By the things he says. All right, you can tell who's somebody who doesn't have wisdom by the things he says. Let me ask, would a man of wisdom say, let's go to the club tonight? Nah. You know what I'm saying? Would a man say, oh, let's go get some prostitutes tonight? They wouldn't say that. That's a fool according to the Bible. All right? Let's read that first.
Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 13. In the lips of him that have understanding, wisdom is found.
In the lips of him who have understanding, which means, according to Psalms 111 and 10, it says that those who fear the Lord, that's the beginning of wisdom, a good understanding of all data, to through his commandments. So it's saying someone who is righteous, someone who keeps God's commandments, wisdom is found. Read on.
But a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding.
But it says a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding, the sinner. Alright, destruction, punishment. It's for that person, that man or woman. You got something?
No.
I'm talking like this, I'm sorry. Alright, from there, let's go to Sirach 4:24. Alright, so showing you a man or a sister of wisdom, alright, someone keeping God's commandments, you can tell by it in their speech. I like the way this one says it right here.
Sirach chapter 4 and verse 24.
Uh-huh.
For by speech, wisdom shall be known.
The scripture says, for by speech, wisdom shall be known. All right? You can always tell, no matter what the situation is, if someone deals with wrath. All right? There's a difference between someone who deals with wrath that's in the world and someone that deals with wrath that's in his truth. All right? Someone that deals with wrath, you say certain things with him, he's going to lose it. He's going to start cussing you out. He's going to start getting hot, balling up his fist, all of that. But someone who's in his truth that dealt with wrath, what? He knows to mind his tongue. He knows to stay in his spirit. He's going to be all right, brother. He's going to be calm and patient with you. Even though he's dealing with that same spirit, he's a man of understanding. Read that again, officer.
Sirach chapter 4 and verse 24.
Uh-huh.
For by speech wisdom shall be known.
Read on.
And learning by the word of the tongue.
All right. Let's go to Sirach chapter 32 and verse 7. Sirach chapter 32 and verse 7. So it is very important that we must watch what we say at all times. Now, a lot of brothers or a lot of sisters, it's funny at times because brothers and sisters have the, how can I say?
Gift of gab.
Yes, they have that. And sometimes they think they're too smart for their own good. All right, so they think that they, by their, like you said, the gift of their gab, they think they can talk their way out of stuff. Front, what's going on, brother?
I need to talk.
Away with words. Very, for example, you know what an orator is? No, I'm sorry. All right, so somebody who's good with words, they say Obama has a gift of gab because he can get the people motivated. He's a smooth talker, all right? So a lot of people are too smart for their own good. Not according to knowledge, but according to man's knowledge. So they think that what they can say to the prophets of the Most High is actually working. No, it's that you can't fake the truth. That's one thing you can't do. The scripture says prove all things, hold fast to that which is true. All right, so the worldly knowledge, the knowledge of this Bible puts worldly knowledge to shame. Just like it says in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. All right, so you can't fake the funk. No matter what you do, just know that if it's not aligned to the scriptures, we may not say something, or the deacons or the bishops may not say nothing, but they can see it. You feel what I'm saying? We know if you're full of it, or if you're actually a man or a sister of wisdom. All right, now, being new to the truth, this is how we know if you got a little bit of wisdom or not. You had a question.
Yeah, I want to know where do we say prove all things at in the Bible?
1 Thessalonians 5:21. Let's read that. Sirach 32:7. This is for the young spirits.
Sirach chapter 32 and verse 7. Speak, young man, if there be need of thee, and yet scarcely when thou art twice asked.
It says, yes, scarcely when out of twice as. Some brothers just ramble. They just talk. Just talk and talk and talk. I'm like, okay. I mean, I'm not rude or anything like that. I'm not going to say nothing. Just let you talk. But what do you think that brother is showing me, brother, Soldier Jacob? If he's just rambling, what do you think he's showing me?
Man, prideful.
Prideful, but what else?
You think he knows it all?
You think he knows it all? All right, what about he knows nothing, right? He knows nothing at all. If he will continue to talk and talk and talk, because it ain't going to be with precepts. Y'all know that. Brothers just coming in, they just like, hey, just talking. You know what I'm saying? Read that, you got something?
No, I was just giving the definition.
Okay.
Brothers, what that means.
Speak, young man, if there be need of thee, yet scarcely when thou art twice asked. So, what does scarcely mean? Not you, brother. Your AC, AP classes. What you got?
definition of
Sure. Scarcity. Read the definition. It says only a short time before. Hold on. Definition not fine. Here we go. Almost not at all or small. Certainly not. And synonyms. All right, it says barely, narrowly, just slightly. So it's not a lot. Think about a lot. Scarcity is the opposite. So very small, very little. That's what scarcity means. I'm going to read it again. Think about that now. It says, speak, young man, if there be need of thee, yet scarcely when thou art twice asked. That make no sense now, brothers? Yes, no, baby.
All right, who can break it down? By a show of hands, who want to break that down? Brothers, when we ask the questions, who are we talking to? We talking to Brother Samuel. We talking to Brother Shmuel. We talking to the new brother, Aphiel, Chris, and the soldiers. So who can break that down? Brother Chris.
So to do more time.
32 and 7. Speak, young man, if there be need be. Which means, all right, say if like you asking the question now. You said need be. You asking the question. It's a need for me to get up and speak, and nobody else put their hand up. So, and yes, scarcely. This means make it quickly, like I mean, as fast as possible. When thou ask twice, you ask twice. I got up, made it, and.
Now, scarcity don't necessarily mean quick. Don't think you gotta be quick. It's just saying a little.
Well,
little.
Make my words as short as possible.
There you go.
And add twice. That's it. That's just 7, right?
Alright. So scripture says, speak, young man, if there be need of thee. Meaning, know your place. Right? You're doing the truth. So really, at the end of the day, what do you have to bring forth? If you don't know anything, what solutions can you bring? That's what the scripture says. Then it says, if there be need of thee, and yet scarcely when thou art asked. So when it is your time to answer, make it short, all right? And you need to be at the reception. Oh, snap, me? You sure? You sure you called on me? All right, and then step up and give the answer. Read on.
Verse 8, let thy speech be short, comprehending much. A few words.
Now that's a skill that needs to be developed. When brothers get asked a question, they think, oh, it's showtime, so now I'm going to just start talking. Nah, that's still for you to give your yays and your nays. All right? Sum it up, get to the point, stop talking. Read on.
Be as one that knoweth and yet holdeth his tongue.
Be as one that knoweth and yet holdeth his tongue. Going into, you don't always have to be the one to answer the questions. All right, even though you know, hold your tongue sometimes. Show charity. All right, read on.
If thou be among great men, make not thyself equal with them.
Mm-hmm.
And when ancient men are in place, use not many words.
Use not many words. So the name of the class is watch your mouth, right? Be mindful of what you say. Be mindful of how you go about things. Thus saith the Lord, right? This is scripture. This is stuff that we didn't learn in the world. In the world, you do whatever what makes you feel good, right? You say what you want, free speech, speak your mind. No, that's not what the scriptures say. There's a time and place for everything, all right? From there, let's go to Proverbs 17 and 27. All right, Proverbs, yes, sir. Yeah, I gave him the scripture.
I thought you were
Proverbs 32 and 7. Watch this.
Sirach took the 32. And verse 7.
Mm-hmm.
Speak, young man, if there be need of thee.
See that? Exactly. Let's go to the next scripture.
Proverbs chapter 17 and verse 27.
Mm-hmm.
Proverbs chapter 17 and verse 27. He that hath knowledge spareth his words.
Read it again.
He that hath knowledge spareth his words.
The scripture says, the man that hath knowledge spareth his words. He's picking and choosing, you know, when is it a necessary time for me to talk? That's what you got to do at all times. It's like, should I talk right now? I don't, you know what? I think they're okay. You know, the officers bring it up. I don't need to talk right now. You feel what I'm saying? Officer's teaching, I'm reading. All right. Officer, hey, the scripture that he's bringing out is fine. Even though I may have a priest up, I'm like, you know what? He's edifying the people. I don't need to speak right now. All right. I'll read that again.
He that hath knowledge spareth his word.
Read.
And a man of understanding is an excellent spirit.
So the man of understanding is of an excellent spirit, right? He's good because he understands what's going on. All right. He's good. Officer bringing it out. Leadership's bringing it out. He's good. He's of an excellent spirit. Even though he may know an answer, he may let his brother answer just because he's a man of understanding. He knows and understands that it doesn't always have to be him. All right. Read on.
Verse 28. Even a fool.
Even a what?
Even a fool, when he holdeth his peace, is counted wise.
Even a fool, when he holds his peace, is counted wise. It's counted wise. Just like a new brother that comes and sits here. All right. He looks at us wise. You feel what I'm saying? He's not giving a sacrifice to fools. Right? He's sitting there and observing. He's retaining it. Says even a fool. He's a fool simply because he may come in with no fringes. You feel what I'm saying? He didn't know how to keep the Sabbath correctly. That's the fool's going into someone who doesn't keep God's commandments. But even that, the contrary, even if they shut their mouth, they're looked upon as wise. All right? Read on.
And he that shutteth his lips is esteemed a man of understanding.
A man of understanding. Because what? That shows that he has control over his spirit. All right? Every time we want to say something, it's not the place. We shouldn't always say it. All right? So we got to pick and choose. Is this worth me saying something right now? Am I needed right now? Or should I just be that man or that woman of peace? Just like the officer was going over before we started. The woman. If a woman is a woman of understanding, she will always shut her mouth when her husband says, do this. When she talks afterwards, she's showing what? She is a fool. She's a fool. Because if the man says, do this, if you have understanding, knowing that the Most High God said, let the woman keep silent, that the man shall have rule over thee. You feel what I'm saying? If she knew that, that means she has some understanding. So why would she do that?
I said, go ahead, huh? Sorry, let me break up the stream. Sirach 20 and 5. Sirach chapter 20 and verse 5. That was heavy. That was heavy right there. And you can see that. Just unearth some diamonds. Alright? Sirach chapter 20 and verse 5.
The book of Sirach, chapter 20 and verse 5.
Uh-huh.
There is one that keepeth silence and is found wise.
So it says there's one that keepeth silence and is found wise. For example, we always say this. If I sit at a table, I got Bishop Nathaniel, Deacon Yaloslav, Deacon Nathan, then you got me, and then you got Captain Hananiah. Let's say I'm sitting at that table. When they talk about Revelation 12, you know, they go on, yeah, you know this, that. I might not know nothing they're talking about. Might not have any precepts to add. But if I sit there and I smile, yeah, open my Bible like I got it, you know. Does anybody know I'm an idiot? No. But when I open my mouth, I say, yeah, man, the dragon, that's just like in Dragon Ball Z, you know, when I was watching that. No, now you look foolish. You look foolish. But if you just silent, you in there. You good to go. Because guess what? Sirach 13 and 15 says, all flesh consorted to his kind. So if you're around wise men and you're not saying nothing, guess what you appear as? You appear as wise. But when you open your mouth, now everybody knows we got to get this brother out of something. He shouldn't be here. Alright, read.
There is one that keepeth silence and is found wise.
Uh-huh.
And another by much babbling becometh hateful.
So some brothers talk so much that they become hateful. It's like, oh snap, this brother coming around. All y'all been around that brother in high school that talk too much. You're like, oh, how does brother find us, man? The brother just talk for no reason. You become hated. That's what the Bible says. Read verse 6.
Verse 6. Some man holdeth his tongue because he hath not to answer.
Right. Some of y'all don't raise your hand because y'all don't know the answer. That's fine. Read.
And some keep in silence, knowing his time.
Some of y'all know the answer, but guess what? You use wisdom. You say, you know what? I'm going to let somebody else answer. That's why Brother Tobin Mordecai, they started to get a little wisdom. What happened? The first week we got to school, we asked the question, Every time. But now they learning. I already know the answer. So I'm going to sit back and let some of these brothers answer the question. They getting some wisdom. All right, read.
A wise man will hold his tongue till he see opportunity.
It says a wise man will hold his tongue till he see opportunity. So even while you in the midst of these deacons and these elders, guess what? They might be like, dang, hey, what's the precept for the light? Guess what? You know what the light is? Oh yeah, that's Proverbs 6:23. Now you appear as wise. Was that a deep precept? No. But guess what? You knew it. You had the correct answer. Now you're counted as wise. You choose your times and spots when you speak. Read.
He that uses many words shall be abhorred.
I'm sorry.
Verse 7. A wise man will hold his tongue till he see opportunity.
Read.
But a babbler and a fool will regard no time.
But a babbler and a fool will regard no time. That's like when a brother get up while bishop teach a class and he stand up, he want to give his 2 cents. Oh yeah, you know, when the FIBA camps came out, this or that. It's like, brother, this is not the time for that. You got to use wisdom when you're speaking. It's not the time. You got to understand what's going on. Alright, read verse 8.
Verse 8. He that useth many words shall be a whore.
There you go again. If you somebody that talk a lot, the scripture says you will become hated. Read.
And he that taketh to himself authority therein shall be hated.
And those two characteristics go together. Brothers that talk a lot are the same brothers that want to be in leadership or a dominant position. And those two, they always go together. Because guess why they're talking so much? Because they desire something. So what do? They talk, they murmur, because they want something. The same thing. All right, y'all understand that?
All right, from there, let's go to the book of Proverbs 10 and 31. Proverbs 10 and 31.
Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 31.
Mm-hmm.
The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom.
Brothers, what does it mean to be just according to the Bible? Brothers, soldiers, what does it mean to be just? Brother Samuel.
Romans 7:14. 7:12.
Alright, we can use Romans 7:12. What else? What you got? Ezekiel 18 and 5. Let's go there real quick. Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 5.
Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 5. But if a man be just and do that which is lawful and right.
So, according to the scriptures, being just is keeping God's laws. All right, doing what's right, which is keeping God's laws. All right, let's go back to Proverbs 10 and 31.
Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 31. The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom. But the forward tongue shall be cut out.
But the forward tongue shall be cut out. All right. So the man of understanding, those who keep God's laws, shall bring forth wisdom. Same thing we've been reading. Precept after precept. But it says the forward tongue. What is it? What does forward mean? What is that? What's the definition of forward? What's that talking about? Forward, F-R-O-W-A-R-D, forward. What is that going into? Brother Appiah, sit up.
Is that like somebody that's like
boastful
and cursing and all of that?
Yeah, going into lewd, going into, you know, just like you said, boasting, just wickedness, all right? Going into being forward, disrespectful, all of that. You got a definition? Are you going to pull up the definition of forward? What is that going into?
Forward. Habitually disposed to disobedience and opposition.
Opposition. What else? What's some synonyms?
Synonyms. Bad. Contrary. Errant. Naughty. Misbehaving. And mischievous.
All right, so let's read that precept again.
Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 31. The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom, but the froward tongue shall be cut out.
Shall be cut out. All right, because there's going to come a day where you're going to have to give an account. All right, actually, let's get that. Let's get that Matthew 12 and 36. You will give an account for everything that comes out of your mouth. All right, that's when that froward tongue shall be cut out in the day of judgment.
Matthew chapter 12 and verse 36. But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment.
In the day of judgment. That's why the name of the class is Watch Your Mouth. Alright, just because you may not say something in front of people, just the fact that you said it, alright, that's still something you have to give an account of. No matter how angry you get, watch your mouth. Let's go to Ephesians 4 real quick. And 26.
Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 26.
Mm-hmm.
Be ye angry.
All right, because the scriptures say we will get angry. Oppression maketh us mad, right? But that doesn't say that you can go before everybody and start saying, hey, we're going to kill all white people. That's stupid. All right? That's foolishness. Read it all the way through.
Be ye angry and sin not.
And sin not. The scriptures say, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. He will repay. All right? So, yeah, you get mad that our people are getting gunned down in the streets. But at the same time, you still have knowledge. All right? You're still staying in the spirit. All right? Let's go back to Matthew real quick. Dealing on the topic of every idle word.
Matthew chapter 12, verse 36.
Mm-hmm.
But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment.
All right, brothers. Knowing that we shall give an account of every idle word that we speak, how do you think we should speak? I need a scripture. I want a scripture. Of course I know what you want. You know what I want.
I know that. I know you want. I think I know what you want. I know that.
All right.
But they should know. You tell
brothers them. Brothers and soldiers.
I know.
What y'all got? Not y'all, not Tallahassee soldiers, but brothers and soldiers. What you got?
1 Peter
chapter 4 and 11, right? All praises. So knowing that we must give an account for every word, if we will speak, we might as well speak the scriptures to be on the safe side, right? All right, let's get that.
1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 11.
Mm-hmm.
If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God.
As the oracles of God. What's that going into, Soldier Jacob, since you bring it up? You want to be justified. You want to be justified. Let's get that in Romans 3, since you said that. Whatever we say, we do want to be justified. We want it to be backed up. We want the Most High to support everything we say. Yes, I like the way you put that. So, Romans chapter 3.
Romans chapter 3 and verse 4. God forbid, yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy saying, and mightest overcome when thou art judged.
Exactly. So when we are judged in that day of judgment, knowing that every idle word we will be judged for, you feel what I'm saying? It's more than important that whenever we feel a certain way, we go over this all of the time. If you catch spirits or you feel a certain way, I'm not going to say it. Brothers, y'all should know this. What should you do before you even speak or before you talk to somebody? If you feel a certain way, what do you need to do first? Hey, I think these brothers going to say, the reason why I wasn't raising my hand is because, you know, I was trying to be wise. I think right now I need y'all to raise your hands, all right? So if you don't, raise your hand, all right? What you got?
2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourself.
Yes. Yes. Examine yourself.
I like that.
All right. Examine yourself. I'm still dealing with you, Brother Sammy. Examine yourself. Why? To do what?
Check your spirit.
Check your spirit. What else? What else?
No.
Not sure? Anybody else want to help? So do you not? What you got?
Ephesians 5:15.
Go and read it.
Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15.
Hey, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise.
Explain it.
So, seeing that you walk circumspectly or cautious whenever you're dealing with people or talking to people, so you can be counted as wise, not as a fool.
All right, I'm going to use, y'all have the beginning of it, right? So if you feel a certain way, say you were offended, right? Or so you think somebody did something to you, feel a certain way. So you examine yourself. Walk circumspect is examining yourself, being careful, right? To do what? You have to find the scriptures. You need to go through the scriptures and see, is my feeling supported with these scriptures? Am I in sin? Are they in sin? I need to reason. You know what I'm saying? Let's get this. This is
John chapter 5 and verse 39.
39, excuse me.
Search the scriptures.
Uh-huh.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
So that was John 5 and 39. It says, search the scriptures, read.
Search the scriptures. For in them ye think you have eternal life.
Because in these scriptures hold eternal life. Showing you that, hey, Proverbs 4 says, within this Bible are the issues of life. So going into this Bible, you must search the scriptures, right? To find out, you know, the way am I feeling? Is this right according to the Bible? I need to go find the scripture to see, how can I do it, my brother? How can I do it, my sister? Or me, myself. Why am I feeling like this? Why am I depressed? Why do I have this addiction? I need to go to the scriptures and find the solution. All right?
Yeah, I got something on that.
All right.
I want to tell a story. So, one time, me and the officer got into it by some cleats. So, I had his cleats. And I wasn't treating them the right way. I had his cleats outside. He wore them inside. I had them outside. So, what I should have did was looked in the Bible and see myself. Because the Bible has every answer. So, what happened the next day in class, came out. And we're going over with people's stuff. Is that your house or not? And you should treat it basically as your own stuff. So, if I would have searched the scriptures in the first place, there wouldn't have been any problems. So make sure, whenever you have anything, whatever you think it is, search the Bible. Guess what? If you can't find it, what should be the next step? What should you do then?
Call your counselor.
Call your counselor. All right? Call your counselor. Because in these scriptures, you'll solve every single issue. Y'all understand that? So exactly what he's saying. Anything you're dealing with, it's going to be in the Bible, some way, shape, or form. All right, but you got to look for it.
Okay. So let's go to the flip side of that. That's when we was niggas. All right? So at that time, I'm gonna just call that person nigga 5 years ago or nigga 3 years ago, whatever that was, 4 or 5 years ago. That nigga kept my cleats outside, right? I was like, that nigga put my cleats inside, right? So he's like, bro, I'm not gonna do it. I was like, why not? You feel what I'm saying? So the nigga and me started getting upset. So I said, all right, this nigga's disrespectful, right? So I was like, you know what? I'm not dealing with that nigga anymore. So what did I do wrong? I cut this man off. Stop dealing with him. So I, on the other hand, because of one person's actions, I did what? I didn't search scriptures either, right? So in return, we were both in sin, right? So dealing with the topic, you said walk circumspect, you said examine yourself, make sure you do the second step and go to the scriptures. Because all day, brother can say like, yeah, I wasn't wrong. Because they say, you know, all they examined it, I wasn't wrong. How do you know you weren't wrong? What's the deciding factor to tell you if we're right or wrong?
Right.
It's the Bible, right? It tells you how you should live and what you have to do to die. That's what it says. Let's get that in 2 Corinthians 7:21. It tells you, It tells you what's right and what's wrong. So it is very evident that we study, learn how to speak to each other. All right? Learn how to study to answer. Study to answer brothers who come to you sincerely in questions. All right? Because when you speak in your speech, as you're studying, as you're changing to that new man or that new woman, it's going to show forth in your speech and in your conversation of who you really are. Let's read that.
2 Ezra chapter 7 and verse 21. But God hath given straight commandments to such as came, what they should do to live.
What they should do to live. So we can search the scriptures and find out what do we have to do to live. Read.
What they should do to live, even as they came. Read. And what they should observe to avoid punishment.
What they should observe to avoid punishment, right? What we were doing was going to get us punishment because we were not showing love or showing charity to each other. But that's what the scriptures say. But while we've known, we didn't have it open, right? So from there, let's go to Colossians 4 and 6. Colossians 4 and 6. Just mentioned how we should study, all right, to give the answers to our brothers and sisters. All right, and it'll show up. You know what? Let's read Proverbs 15 and 28, then Colossians 4 and 26. I'm sorry, 4 and 6. Showing you how your habits create your speech. All right, the way you start living your life is going to change. Everybody can say, you're not even the same person. You don't even talk the same. You don't even joke the way you used to joke around. You know what I'm saying? Because now you're changing as a new man, a new creature. All right, let's read that.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 28. The heart of the righteous studieth to err, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things.
Whatever they want, you feel what I'm saying? Nigga, give me my cleats or I'ma kill you, alright? I'm tired of you disrespecting me, I'ma come burn your house down, nigga. Because that's what a wicked person says. You took my cleats outside, they got rained on, they got dirty. Now, nigga, you got to pay. Right? But, the heart of the righteous is going to go through, search through the scriptures and find Matthew 18 and 15. He's going to say, brother, you know what? You offended me by disrespecting my property. All right? And then that brother's either going to do what? He's either going to hearken down to the scriptures or he's going to rebel against the scriptures. All right? Let's read that all the way through again.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 28. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer.
Read.
But the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things.
Poureth out evil things. All right, let's go to Colossians 4 and 6.
Hey, before we go, I got to read this story for them.
All right.
So maybe somebody else can avoid that issue. 2 Kings 6.
Gotcha.
And 1. Just to show you, when somebody leaves something at your house, the way you should feel about somebody else's property or possession. The way you should treat it. Like for instance, right now I got a brother clothes in my house. He showed up 1 week and he gave me like 10 shirts. Nice shirts. They fringed up, hanging up. But I'm not wearing them. I ain't leaving them outside. I'm taking care of them. Why? Because he might come back. And he gonna need that. And that can be an example showing we keep the commandments. Alright? Read that though. 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse 1.
The book of 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse 1. And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, behold now, the place where we dwell with these is too straight for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam. And let us make a place there where we may dwell.
All right, so they got to make their own dwelling places. Read.
And he answered, go ye. And one said, be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood.
So now they're in the forest, they're cutting down wood, read.
But as one was felling a beam,
They was cutting it down.
The axe head fell into the water.
So he chopped it, and then the axe head fell off, broke off and fell into the water, read.
And he cried and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed.
So he wasn't worried that the axe, the beam, or he couldn't work no more. He was sincerely sad because he understood that was somebody else's axe he was using. That's the way we got to be when you're dealing with other people's things. All right, read verse 6.
6. And the man of God said, where fell it? And he showed him the place.
Uh-huh.
And he cut down a stick and cast it in thither.
Uh-huh.
And the iron did swim.
Read.
Therefore said he, take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and took it.
So he didn't just see it go into the water and say, oh, man. All right, let me get another one. No. He made sure he got his property back, took care of it, and was able, it was in good working progress again. All right, so that's how you should be when you're dealing with other people's things. I know as the boys, brothers and sisters, come to each other's houses, and we open up our homes to one another, things get left behind. That's what happened. So make sure you're taking care of each other's things, just like it's yours. All right, you understand that?
Sure.
All right. Am I saying
all right, let's read that Proverbs again.
All right. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 28. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things.
The mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. So we're not trying to be like the wicked. We're trying to be like the righteous that studieth to answer. So in our speech, keep in mind, the name of the class is Watch Your Mouth. All right? So we need to be circumspect. We need to watch what we say. All right, so when people ask questions, we're not giving the sacrifice of fools. We're not just telling them what we want to tell them. We're actually giving them the solutions according to the scriptures. Let's read that, Colossians 4 and 6.
Colossians chapter 4 and verse 6. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man.
That ye, how you ought to answer every man, which is speech. All right, because the tongue has the power to give life and death. Alright? As prophets of the Most High, we're called watchmen. So if you give wrong counsel, if you lead someone astray by your own thoughts, being evil, speaking whatever you want, you will have to give an account for that. Alright? So make sure we study it so we can teach the next man, right? According to the scriptures, not just what you want to teach. Alright? Let's go to Sirach 6 and 5. Switching gears a little bit. Sirach chapter 6, verse 5. Going into friendships. How we ought to treat brothers and sisters. All right? How to be cordial. Because in the world, a lot of us don't know how to do that. It's either some people just naturally friendly, or some people just don't talk. Some people think when you talk to them, you're being rude. Some people take offense. All right? So let's see what the scriptures say, how we ought to deal in our speech, all right?
Sirach chapter 6 and verse 5. Sweet language will multiply friends.
It says sweet language will multiply friends. All right, it says sweet language will multiply friends, read on.
And a fair speaking tongue will increase kind greetings.
Will increase kind greetings. So if you want to be treated good, what happens? You start doing it, and in return, people will give you kind greetings, right? So be friends. Hey, shalom, brother. Shalom, sis. Don't be the brother who just walks in and never says anything. Right? I got to be conscious of that, too. Because that's what I always did in the world. I ain't. All right. If I don't know you, I'm not speaking to you. That's how I was. You know what I'm saying? So in repentance, I got to reform that. I got to change that. I just can't walk into a room and not shalom people. And have I made mistakes? Yes. But it's a conscious effort. All right? It's a conscious effort to constantly change. All right? Kill off that old man. All right, from there, let's go to the book of Proverbs 15 and 1. All right, to, how can I say, to smooth things over in regards to, like, friendships. When I'm speaking with each other, watch this, Proverbs 15 and 1.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 1.
Uh-huh.
A soft answer turneth away wrath.
A soft answer turneth away wrath. So let's say a brother or sister was out of the spirit, right? You being in the spirit, you can calm them down and get them back on focus. If they come at you sideways, answer them kindly. Then they're like, you know, let me get right. Because I was talking to that brother and sister all wrong. Bro, I read it again.
A soft answer turneth away wrath.
But this is even going into people of the world. Think about when we at camp. We got some people who may have the spirit of murder on them. They may come to the camp for that intention so they can get us hyped. They come pissed off, things like that. But it says a soft answer turneth away wrath. So you got to be knowledgeable of the scriptures. You got to know, hey, nigga, if you don't repent, you're going to die. You can't say that to a brother who has a spirit of murder on him. You know what I'm saying? You got to know how to deal with that brother or that sister. Hey, brother, you know, what's love according to the Bible? Start off like that. Now, what we out here, we're for our people, all right? I'm going to show love to you, brother, because according to Leviticus 19 and 17, I have to show love according to the Bible. So this is what I'm going to go to. Go to fringes. Go to Matthew 5 and 17. Go to dietary love. Start teaching this brother. You feel what I'm saying? Don't just blast this brother. Know how to deal with your brothers and sisters. Let's read it again from the top.
A soft answer turn up away wrath, but grievous words store up anger.
That's how the cat gets jumped, all right? Brothers, first time teaching, they just want to blast. They just want to yell. All right? You mess with the wrong one, they're going to tear up the camp. All right? Read on.
The tongue of the wise uses knowledge. All right.
Uh-huh. What is knowledge according to the Bible? Brother Shmuel, stand up.
Knowledge according to the Bible, Malachi 2:7.
Using God's words, right? Speaking God's words is the knowledge of this Bible. So I'll read it again, opposite.
The tongue of the wise uses knowledge. All right. But the mouth of fools pours out foolishness.
All right. So be circumspect. Be mindful. All right. Watch your mouth. Watch what you're saying. All right. From there, let's go to Sirach 9 and 18.
All right. And going into that as well. You can be right, but the way you say it make it seem wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So understand that you can have the right, correct answer, but the way you say the answer, your tone, your body language, it'll make it all wrong. All
right.
Sirach chapter 9.
Verse 18.
Oh, 18. Yes, Sirach chapter 9 and verse 18. A man of an ill tongue is dangerous.
He is what?
Is dangerous.
He is dangerous. A man of an ill tongue, you don't want to be around that man or that woman. I seen a video, somebody posted it on Facebook. They was on like a subway train. And this dude had a rebellious girlfriend. She was going off on another dude. Just selling him out. And what happened? She got her boyfriend drugged, beat down because she couldn't shut her mouth. All right, read that again.
A man of an ill tongue is dangerous.
It's dangerous because they're going to bring harm not only to themselves but to others. Read on.
And he that is rash in his talk shall be hated.
Shall be hated. All right, keep in mind, you can't be reckless. All right, coming into repentance. All right. Let's go to the book of 1 Corinthians 15 to 33.
Right. And going into 1 Corinthians 15 to 33.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, going into that, it's just like we all had that one friend that's that firecracker in your group. You scared to go anywhere with this brother because you know if this brother get around the wrong, he's going to say something. You're going to have to defend yourself. Make sure you're not that brother no more. You got to repent of that. You can't be that brother in the truth, all right? When brothers don't feel comfortable to take you someplace. If I can't bring you to my job without you risking, you say, hey, yeah, you know you're the devil, right? You can't be that brother. You got to use wisdom. Y'all would be surprised. 15 and 33.
Yes, sir.
1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 33. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners.
Just like the officer just said, you can't be around brothers and sisters like that. Because after a while, if that's the person you deal with, what's going to happen to you? It says evil communication. So this is a fact that you're hearing that all the time. You can't escape the scriptures. The scriptures say evil communication corrupt good manners. So that's telling you, you cannot constantly be around evil communication. Would you agree, Brother Sam? You can't always be around evil communication. That's going to do what to your spirit? It's going to kill your spirit. Because hey, at one point you were strong in the truth, and then after a while, you complacent. You're like, what's going on? I don't know what's going on. Because you need to check your surroundings. You need to check who you're dealing with on a daily basis. All right, from there, let's go to the book of Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 4. Page 2.
4 and 2.
Yeah. No. 4 and 12. 4 and 12.
Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 4 and verse 12. For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest.
It says the bewitching of naughtiness does obscure. Who knows what obscure means? Who want to take a shot at that? Obscure. Think about the way it's used. You got something? Go ahead.
Obscure is to like for example, you look in the mirror and it's obscure, it's blurring your vision.
Thank you. Spot on. Spot on, exactly. It says, for the bewitching of naughtiness does obscure things. It throws things off. It throws you off of that straight and narrow. All right? It says, for the bewitching of naughtiness does obscure things that are honest. And the wandering of concupiscence doth undermine the simple mind. Let's get the definition of concupiscence. For the brothers, let's get that definition. So y'all see, communication, your tongue is very important. It's serious. What we say, all right, turns into what we do. Turns into how we live, right? Because it said the tongue defileth the whole body. All right, so we got to be very mindful of what we say.
Concupiscence, a strong desire, a strong sexual desire. Synonyms, horniness, hot, lustfulness, passion.
So when it says, and the wandering of concupiscence, now you know what concupiscence means, does undermine the simple mind, the young mind, the simple. Because what does it say? I can't quote it. Proverbs says, the simple believe of everything.
Yep. Proverbs 14 and 15.
Let's go there. Proverbs 14 and 15. It says, the simple believe of everything. So if they're constantly around evil communication and concupiscence, what's going to become of that simple mind? Right? Eventually, they're going to have those wandering ears, and that's going to be them. All right? It's going to defile the whole body. Let's read that.
Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 15.
Mm-hmm.
The simple believeth every word, but the prudent man looketh well to his goal.
But the prudent man, the brother who's diligent, who's circumspect, who studies, who examines himself, looketh well to his goal. All right? Because he understands the magnitude of being around evil communication on a daily basis. All right? So he'll find a way out of that. All right. From there, let's go to Wisdom of Solomon 1 and 11. Now we're going to change gears again in regards to our speech and our tongue. Going into murmuring, all right? Slightly, I ain't going to deal too much.
Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 1 and verse 11. Therefore, beware of murmuring, which is unprofitable.
Which is unprofitable, read.
And refrain your tongue from backbiting.
Brother Shmuel, what is backbiting? Say no.
Talking about somebody back.
Talking about somebody back, exactly. So, read again from the top.
Therefore, beware of murmuring, which is unprofitable, and refrain your tongue from backbiting. For there is no word so secret that shall go for naught.
That shall go for naught. It's going to come to light. All right, it will come to light. What's that in the gospel? Most I say they'll bring it to light.
2 Ezra chapter 16 and verse 63. Surely he knows your invention and what you think in your heart. Even them that would sin and would hide their sin.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore hath the Lord exactly searched out all your works. And he will put you all to shame.
He will put you all to shame. Like it said, that there's nothing that's going to remain in the dark. All right? Like I said, it wasn't a Solomon. Everything will come to light in due time. All right? Let's go to Ephesians 5 and 1. We'll read down a little bit. Keep in mind, this is watch your mouth. So going into things that you find not so serious, like joking. Joking with one each other. Everything is not okay to joke about with certain people. All right, you got to know what you can joke about and what you cannot joke about. Some can take offense, some can be disrespectful, some people can be deeply hurt about your jokes. So you need to know that person, all right, and know who you're dealing with. All right, let's go to Ephesians 5 and 1.
Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us, and has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becoming saints.
Mm-hmm. So the Most High says, let none of this evil be named amongst any of us, read on.
Neither filthiness, Nor foolish talking.
So, yes, we joke around, but the righteous joking around is so much different from when worldly people joke around. Y'all gotta understand that. You can't, some things people coming into this truth say, you like, wow, I can't believe they just said it. You know the spirit ain't right. You know what I'm saying? There's certain things you will never joke about. There's certain things you will never say as a repentant brother or sister. Read on.
Neither filthiness nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient.
Nor jesting, which are not convenient. Brothers, who knows what jesting means? Or to jest, who knows what that means? Any ideas? Nor jesting? What you got? Stand up.
That's like, in Miami they call it ranking one of, like, somebody's trying to get down on you and they say, oh no, nah, I'm just playing with you, but they jesting, they mess with you.
Exactly, joking, cracking on each other, like he says, ranking, exactly. That's what that's going into. But what, listen what it says, nor jesting, which are not convenient. So there's a time and place for everything, like it says in Ecclesiastes. You need to know what you can say, when to say it, you know what I'm saying? Is it the right place to say when Bishop is teaching class to raise your hand and just bust out with a joke? Is that the right time to say that? It's not convenient. It's not the right time for that. Say a brother just lost a loved one. Is it the right time to say things like casket sharp? Things like that? No. Say that brother is like, damn, he's thinking about his loss. That's not the smartest thing to do. You need to think about what you're saying. You know what I'm saying? You got something?
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 10 and 23. I'll read it. It says, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but all things edify not. So you got to understand where to draw the line at. Are we saying it's a sin to make a joke? Like Brother Samuel fell today. Okay, that's fine. Now, is it expedient to bring that up when the bishop is going over something? No. Make sure you use wisdom. It's the same thing it says a wise man findeth, he chooses his time when he makes jokes and stuff like that. You find the time. All
right? Right. So let's go to James chapter 3 and verse 13. James chapter 3 and verse 13. Now we're going into leadership. As leaders, what type of speech should leaders have? All right, let's read that. James 3 and we start at verse 13.
James chapter 3 and verse 13.
Uh-huh.
Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you?
So it said, who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let's examine a wise man. Hold that. Let's go to Proverbs 12 and 8. Proverbs 12 and 8. It says, who is a wise man and endued with knowledge? Let's see what, we'll see what that wise man is.
Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 8.
Uh-huh.
A man shall be commended according to his wisdom.
He shall be commended according to his wisdom. We've read multiple precepts that says what? About the way you speak. A man of knowledge, he's going to speak wisdom and understanding. All right, so the scripture says a man shall be commended according to his wisdom. Commended, he's going to be the one amongst everybody who's going to be that leader. He's going to be that example because he has wisdom. All right, you cleave to that which has the wisdom. Read on.
But he that is of a perverse heart shall be despised.
All right, let's go back to the book of James, 3:13.
James chapter 3 and verse 13.
Uh-huh.
Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you?
Read.
Let him show out of a good conversation.
Let him show out of a good conversation. The way he carries himself, what comes out of his mouth. Read.
His works with meekness of wisdom.
Read on.
But if you have bitter envy and strife in your heart, glory not and lie not against the truth.
And lie not against the truth. All right, so if you have those type of spirits, check your spirit. All right, don't blaspheme. Don't speak against leadership. All right, don't speak against brothers and sisters. Check your spirit. Get yourself in line. All right, read on. Verse 15.
This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish.
All right, because it says bitter envy and strife. All right, that's not of the Most High. That is fleshly. That is carnal. All right, so get rid of that. Read.
For where envy and strife is, There is confusion in every evil work.
Read.
But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality.
Without partiality, read.
And without hypocrisy.
And without hypocrisy. All right, so in order to be a good leader, you have to be able to betray those traits, all right, of good conversation, knowing how to deal with everybody. Let's go to Judith 8 and 24. All right, because you got to think, soldiers, officers, the bishop can't say any and everything. Why? Because every last word that Bishop Nathaniel says, somebody is waiting for him to slip. They're waiting for to catch the bishop up in his words. We go to Ghana, they say, what the hell y'all doing out there with all those Hamites? You can't do any, he can't do anything, right, without somebody saying something. So he has to be circumspect to the max that he is always doing thus save the Lord. And that's how we, that's our mind frames as leaders. Leaders in training. That's how we need to be. I can't say any and everything. I have to be an example. I have to watch what I say at all times. Let's read that.
Judith chapter 8 and verse 24. Now therefore, O brother, let us show an example to our brother, because their hearts depend upon us.
Let us show that example. How can we show that example? Through studying. So when they ask us questions, we're able to answer. Alright? And say if you don't know the answer, think about your conversation. Say, brother, you know what? I'm not sure about that. Be honest. Don't lie to them. Alright? And show them an example that if you don't know, you don't have to be prideful. You can tell them you don't know. And say, let's say if you gave wrong counsel before because you thought that was right, and you find out that it was wrong, you correct it. And say, brother, I apologize about that. I had that wrong. Here is the correct understanding on that. Be an example, all right? From there, let's go to Titus 2 and 8. Let's start at 6.
Titus chapter 2 and verse 8. Young men, likewise, exhort to be sober-minded. In all things, showing thyself a pattern of good works. In doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity.
Read.
Sound speech,
read.
That cannot be condemned.
Soldier Jacob hit it on the head earlier. What type of speech cannot be condemned? What type of staff, Brother Afia?
Justifying the saying, speaking the truth.
Exactly, when you speak in the scriptures, that can never be condemned. Because God's word is going to stand against any man's words, read.
Sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of him.
Having no evil thing to say of him. They can't say anything against us, and that infuriates them. They know we're right, but we have to stay in the scriptures. We have to be studied, no matter what the situation.
Yep, I'll give you an example. On the job, I got a wicked Jake, and then the brother that came last week, either brother I got, and then the other Jake, he's an old wicked man. So whenever he asks me a question about the Bible, I give him a scripture. So now, when he asks me just a normal question, like he'd be like, hey, what up, what you hear today? And I'll tell him, he'd be like, oh, that ain't in the Bible. But he's showing you, he knows if it's a true question, I'm going to give him a scripture. That's all I'm saying. And I'm justified in my saying. He can't say nothing evil about me. He can't say I'm this, I'm that. Because I give him the scripture and he take it or leave it. That's what it is. But make sure that when you use the Bible, because everybody loves the Bible. So when you give it to them, might not be a scripture, but they don't say nothing. They ain't gonna take that to the boss and them. They ain't gonna do it. They just going, oh, all right. They go with the Bible. That's what happens.
What was it at?
Titus chapter 2 and verse 8. Sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say.
I got about a few more scriptures. That's a better going right there. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Damn. That's good. That's good right there. Ephesians 4 and verse 29.
Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth,
let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. You know what? I'm going to use an example. Damn. The word damn. Now, when I first came to truth, I was like, damn, these brothers be saying damn a lot. This is a speech class, right? We're going over, can I be justified if I say damn? Can I be justified? You say, yeah? What you got? It's in the Bible, right? Now, is there a place and a time where I can say that? Damn. Should I say it everywhere, though? Nah, because everything's not expedient. You know what I'm saying? Y'all understand that? All right. Let's read that again.
Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth.
Read.
But that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC. To stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.